Well, good afternoon, everybody. We're sort of heading towards that 3 o'clock mark where we're free, eh? And already, I'm sure for you this afternoon, you've received today so much already. You know, hasn't it been good so far? It's been brilliant, hasn't it? So they've asked me to speak to you on leading through others. And I just want to say to you that I really do believe for 35 years, like when I was 5 years of age, you see, the Lord called me. What it was, I've always carried a belief that the best days of the Salvation Army are before us, not behind us. And that's an incredible thought, really, eh? Because our past has been glorious. Right? Our past has been glorious. You know, we saw something of that last night, and, you know, the catch-up. Now for me to make a statement that I'm of the belief that that the best days of the Salvation Army actually are before us, there's got to be a change in our thinking. Because, you see, many of us have a problem with the mind. The problem is that we are restricting what God would want to do by our thinking. And it was so refreshing to have somebody from outside of the movement come to us today and just say to us, dream big, really. You know, we sit there and say, oh, way to go. Well, you know, I'm just saying to you today, I think we've got to get serious about it has all been laid out what we need to do. Our issue today is, when are we going to start doing it? Right? When are we going to start doing it? And this whole thing of me coming, you know, I was asked to do, you know, will you do this leading through others thing, you know, that you do, because you obviously, look, I want to take you on a journey for a wee while, and I want to say to you that Glenda and I, we have lived this. This is not about some ideas. This is just about a vision that we caught and thought, well, if we go pursue this, what could happen? And when I meet people who come and they sit and they say, you know, let's have a listen to this. And then what they do, what we do is we sit and we listen when we say, oh, no. And then they come afterwards and say, well, I don't know. We don't actually see what you see in our ministry. And I make it, it's very simple. Well, you're not doing what I'm doing. I've just hit a major stronghold in the Salvation Army. The stronghold is this, that we think that we can do what we're doing, and when we get guys like Paul De Jong in, and, you know, and we sit in them, and we say, nah, and then we say, why can't we have a ministry like Paul De Jong? Because we're not doing. We're not thinking. We're not being. You with me? So I have to preempt this, because some of you have heard this so many times. I need to preempt everything I'm doing. So here we go. There are four things I want to do very quickly. I want to give you a biblical viewpoint of where I see this whole subject. I want to talk about a culture of empowerment. I want to talk about recruiting leaders. I want to talk about developing leaders. And around about 8 o'clock tonight, we should finish. No, we won't. So here we go. This is where it's at for me. The key lifestyle that you and I are to live, very simple, is that we're to love God passionately, and we're going to love people. All right? Tick yourself off, okay? Because you're on this journey with me. You're saying, well, I think if I've got his introduction, what he's going to do is he's going to speak out of what his life is. Now he's calling us quite to live how he lives. So here we go. We're going to love God passionately, and we're going to love people. There may even be people in this room who says, it's not my personality to love people. No. We were created to love. Now, if you're feeling like, gee, this is quite radical, that we should love God passionately, we should love people, I just want to say it is the great commandment, okay? all right? And every person in this room, that's the mandate that you're given. That's the key lifestyle that we're to live. And, you know, so for me over the days, you know, I've had people say to me, Ivan, why can't I, you know, draw from this person what I see that you could draw from them? It's simple. You don't even like them. You with me? Well, if you think it's going to get really big, this is how big it gets for us today. If you walk down a corridor and you've got people coming your way and you just ignore them, don't think for one moment you're going to lead them. The key lifestyle of a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ today is that we're going to love God passionately, we're going to love people. And you say, I don't do that, well, you're struggling on first base. My temperament is not to do this, well, we all need help. That's why he gave us the Holy Spirit. So there's no excuses. So you cannot develop leaders if you don't love God passionately and love people. I just don't think so. Not what we're after. The key objective for you and I is to make disciples. See, Jesus said, you know, one day we're going to stand. You're thinking that one day we're going to stand before the Lord and we're going to tell him how well we did health and safety audits. I tell you, it's not like that. The thing that I really believe with all my heart that he's going to talk to me around is the great commission he gave us. And that is what? To make disciples. That's what we're called to do. One day, we're all going to stand before the Lord, and he's going to talk to us about the commission. Some people have said to me, Ivan, you're that expert guy, that guru guy on discipleship. Well, I want to know who you are. Because in my mind, that's all that I thought the Lord gave us a commission to do, was to go to the world and make disciples. I wonder what our world would be different if the church got that, understood that today, that all we're asked to do is to go and make disciples. Okay? Some would say this is too simplistic. All I'm saying that I've been able to find a lifestyle that could do this. The third thing that I think is our assignment, I really believe this, is that our assignment is not to get people to heaven. I believe that our assignment is to get heaven on earth. I believe that the assignment of the church, the assignment of the Salvation Army in New Zealand, Fiji and Tonga is to invade the impossible. We were created to invade the impossible. One day, when the Lord calls me home, I will spend eternity in heaven, but I really haven't got a great picture of what eternity will actually look like. All I know is what he calls me to do today, and that is to get his world into my world. And I don't know about you, but that seems to be becoming more and more impossible. That's why I love the challenge, because that's why he commissioned us and called us. And the key learning that I've learned over the years is this, and I see it as a biblical, is that all disciples are leaders. So Jesus is going to raise leaders that will radically change the world. Agree? He doesn't call them leaders. He calls them what? When he says to the church before the empowerment, before Acts 2, in Matthew 28, he says, now go into the world and make. Well, why didn't he say leaders? Because leaders are the ones that are going to change the world. He didn't know what he's talking about, you see. He needed it to live in today to understand. No, he understood very clearly that if you have disciples, you've got leaders. Right? What's the number one issue of the Salvation Army today? I believe it's discipleship. I believe if we're really honest that, like, you know, I'm doing review after review after review, and I'm still thinking that the most critical issue in the Southern Division is in the area of discipleship making. If you make disciples, you're going to raise leaders. Is that all right? Have I ruined it for you now? Me and technology. There you go. Thank you. Well done. All right. Don't worry, I've spoken to very large crowds and done this, so this is all good. Okay, so here we go. We got Jesus, and I cannot understand why he didn't come today. Because, man, if he had come today, we could have really helped him, couldn't we? We would have trained him brilliantly, and of all the stuff that he needed to know. But the Bible says, just at the right time, the Bible says, he comes into the world, right? His motivation for coming is to bring heaven to earth. His key focus will be the kingdom of God. He will teach his disciples when they come to him and they say to him, Master, teach us how to pray. He'll teach them a prayer that's impossible. No, he'll teach them a prayer that he actually believes should be answered. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on as is in heaven. Well, he's lying. No, he's teaching the prayer from Father God, right? He's saying this is the prayer that God wants to answer, okay? And so he's now going to bring about, he's looking at a whole world that basically needs to be redeemed, needs to be brought back into the rulership of God the Father, okay? And what he will do, the strategy he will use, is that he will go to 12 people. And basically what he'll do is, in this slide, to fulfill his assignment, he will select 12 disciples and he will illustrate a life which inspires others to want to follow. He will cast a vision that others will want to lay down their life for. And he will train them in a way in which they will be empowered to fulfill the assignment for their lives achieved through relationships. And what he'll basically do is this little thing down the bottom, is that he will model the lifestyle that they are to live. He will then invite them to be in part of a team environment. Even when he would send them out, he would never send them out by one. He would send them out in twos. And then later on, once they started together, then he began to encourage them to be involved in solo. And all the time, there's a word that's missing down the bottom there, is that he would evaluate. He will always evaluate. If you're saying, what is the strategy for me to develop leadership? This is the strategy. Call people to come and be connected to you in relationship in such a way that you will live your life out in front of them that will inspire others to say, I want to do that. That's what Jesus did. Okay? That's what he did. And I'm of the belief that what over 35 years of ministry, I've thought, well, why don't we give that a go and let's see what happens? Why don't we chase that sense of understanding of what we're to do with people? And he invites them to life and he calls them to watch. And now when I've taught this around the place, there have been many people who've sat in the training sessions who've said to me, Ivan, this is the way of the apprenticeship model within trades. Right? This is what they do. You know, our own son here, Nathan, he's a very good mechanic. He started off as an apprentice. This was the model that was used to him. Nathan was assigned to a tradesman who already had a lifestyle, and he began to work with them, watch with them, develop. There came a point that the person said, now you do it, Nathan, and he always got evaluated. At the end of the day, it was quite interesting because sometimes I'd walk in there and I'd watch the tradesman and Nathan, who they had an incredibly great relationship, and you would see that there was a way that they would walk the same way, they'd pick up tools the same way. It was quite scary. All right? But that's the way that Jesus taught. Here is the verse that I've thought is true. because it's in the Bible. Luke 6, verse 40, he says, students are not greater than their teacher, but the student who is fully trained will become like the teacher. Okay? I actually believe that that's true. This business about you should be your own individual, I don't know where we got that one from. That's something I'm going to ask God about when I get to him, because I've never actually understood that, because God's economy is always that he's put us in a family. He's never wanted us to pursue our own identity. Where did we get that? I don't know where we got that one from, but that's a very strong message. In other words, what do you expect? I expect that when I first start calling people and when I first start bringing around, they're going to start talking like me, they're going to start looking like me in some ways, and there's going to be a sense that people are going to look and they're going to say, oh yeah, I know who you've been with. And listen, that's good news to me. I don't know what it is to you, but it's good news to me. There are people who have come to me and they've said to me, listening to Paul DeYoung this morning I heard, well, we were raised in the same family. We talked the same. Yeah. So they went to Jesus. Jesus is gone. And they started to look at the disciples and they started to say, oh, I thought we got rid of Jesus. But look, they recognized them to be these ones to look like Jesus. Some of us are so scared of getting into relationships with people. Why? Yeah, I can understand it, because you've been hurt so many times. And that's why we've got to start looking at, that's why we need accountability. That's why we need to hear messages of failure. Because the reality is that there are many times that I've been in relationship, discipleship relationship, and the people that I followed have failed me. My spiritual dad today, who I just look like, I talk like, I so many people who have known him, he's not even in ministry today. He's lost. But I need people who carry something of God that I will go to and join to, because I'm wanting that whatever they carry would be imparted into me. So you're going to have your failures. You're going to have, but listen, this doesn't stop us from joining in a way when we're with people in relationship, because guess what? You think you're not discipling? You are. You think you're not influencing? You are. I just choose to make sure that when people are watching me, they might see something that's worth seeing. You understand this? Yeah? It's a biggie. Many of you are husband and wife here. Many of you got children. You've been discipling. Don't you understand that? Do you take a look at your kids? Does it not scare you? Does it not scare you when you see the children saying, and you're wanting to say, where would they have caught that from? Knowing in your heart of hearts, you know exactly where that came from. This, in the sense of the physical, is the same, first in the natural, then in the spiritual. This is how it is in the spirit. So one of the big things for me that I've learned over the years is to understand this scripture in Matthew chapter 20. I'll just tell you what it is. It's a landowner. He's going out and he's wanting to pick people to come and work in his vineyard. He's got a job to be done. Now Jesus illustrates this scripture because he says the kingdom of God is like. And so for me, what it means is that every time I see this, the kingdom of God is like, I'm thinking, well, this is what the kingdom of God is like. Okay, So Jesus says, the kingdom of God is like this. So I'm listening, I'm saying, well, what is it? He says, it's like a landowner who goes out and he meets up with some people and he says to these people, what are you doing? And they reply, I'm doing nothing. Well, I want to employ you in my vineyard. And he'll go out three times during the day and he'll have that conversation with people. He will go out and he will say, what are you doing? Each time. And some people, want to start thinking around, they all got paid the same, came the end of the day, some got paid, how fair was that? No, the key for me that I've got out of the story of the kingdom is this, that I need to look for people who carry a vision for my life. because it's the way of the kingdom. The way of the kingdom of God is that he is wanting to create people in such a way that when we look at people, all of a sudden we'll get vision for that person's life. It's the way of the kingdom. Many of you here are senior leaders, for instance. Everyone, if you're a senior leader today, this is what God wants you to do. He wants you to be able to go around your everyday, and as you look at people, you get a vision for people. And the key point that you'll have, the point of the story is this, that you could get into a conversation with the person, and you could say to the person, what are you doing? And they're likely to say, I'm doing nothing. And you're saying, well, why aren't you engaged? Why aren't you doing something? Because no one has employed me. Now this has been a really key teaching for me, because my key life expectation is this, that I expect this to be how it is, it will be. So I look for it in life as I go around in life. So as I now live, when I meet people, when I'm talking to people, I'm saying, God, what is it for this person? And now I look in around this room, and you know, thank you for coming, those of you, you know, because many of you know me. Thanks for coming, but you see. You see, we're still here because of relationship. There's a sense. I look around at room, and there have been moments when some of you might want to say, well, I haven't actually spoke something into my life. Well, why? Because he's gifted? No. Because I think that this is what God does. There are people. There are your children. There are people in your life that you're coming in contact with all the time. And what God is wanting you to do is for you to carry a vision for their life. And to then to employ them, to engage them in such a way that you're going to draw that vision out of them. All right? Let's move on. So how do we lead through others? I want to talk to you about building a culture of empowerment. The key of building a culture of empowerment, you have to do this. You see, Jesus empowered guys. You think about it. He takes a bunch of guys that really, at the end of the day, they got no life skills at all, really. You know, you look at the way they were. You know, they were a motley bunch. And what he does is he empowers them. Now, I've chased this thought. What if we could build a culture of empowerment that people could feel free to chase whatever they believe God, you know, if I see a vision or they believe themselves that God is calling them to do something, what would it be like for them, a culture of empowerment? Now, I think that this is a really big one for the Salvation Army, because here's my point. This is a Murray Robertson quote, okay? Murray Robertson said years ago, he said, if you're not empowering people, you are controlling them. All right? If you're not empowering people, you're controlling them. Parents, if in your family life, if you are controlling your children, you are not empowering them. Now this is I'm taking my time on this one, because this is a biggie. Now let me just say to you, to control is not evil, is not demonic. Okay? To control is not evil, it is not demonic. But when you are controlling, you're not empowering. I'm going to take my time over this one, because this is a biggie for us in the Salvation Army. If we are not empowering, we will be controlling. If we are controlling, we're not empowering. To control is not evil. It is not demonic. You're not going to go to hell because you're a control freak. Isn't that good news? Right? But you will not be empowering people. Okay? Now, when I walk into a situation, when my children were young, and if I walked into a situation, I thought there was a moment of risk going on, and I took control. I'm being a good parent, aren't I? But I'm telling you, at that moment, I am not empowering those children. I'm taking control. This is really, really important. Because in this movement, we have a controlling spirit because we're doing it. Why? Because we want people to be safe. But to control is not to empower. Okay? So, well, let's just define empowerment then. So I went to the dictionary because I don't know. I'm another one. I got 27% in English. So, culture of empowerment, to give power and authority to, this is empowerment, to delegate, to give ownership. This is me. To give responsibility without ownership is to abuse. Now, when I say this is me, what I mean by this is that one day I sat with a counselor, and the counselor said to me, if you give somebody ownership but don't give them responsibility, that's a level of abuse. Okay? So, in other words, this is another one. If in the Salvation Army I give you responsibility, but I don't give you ownership, I'm abusing you. All right, I'm abusing you. You'll get hurt. You know this, don't you? You know this. This is true. But you look. I believe totally in the Salvation Army. Okay, so you're not looking at a disloyal officer here. Totally believe in the movement. But we've got to understand where we're living, because that's what's helped me. Now, if I'm going to say to somebody, I want to give you this responsibility, I got to give them ownership. If the moment I give them ownership, I want to take control of that, it is an abusive relationship. I am not empowering them. Okay? All right? So, just going on, set high standards of performance, not pursuing perfection, but pursuing excellence. This is my idea of a culture of empowerment. Supporting people with training, mentoring, coaching, giving resources and authority to succeed. It says getting out of the way and giving the opportunity to excel is that last point. Okay, and I understand you're going to get a copy of these notes when you leave. Okay, so I should have said that earlier. All right. Okay. So at this moment, you've got a ownership responsibility as you're going on. Okay. Now, listen, this culture of empowerment will create messy, right? If you can't handle messy, you are in trouble. I don't like messy. I like things in order, you know, but I understand that in the way of the ministry and in kingdom, I've got to be able to embrace messy if I'm going to develop others. So what am I saying? I'm wanting somebody, first of all, to come into relationship with me. I want them to get close enough to me because I'm hoping you'll catch something from me. I might, you know, there's this thing that some of you will know. What condition do you have? If I talk to you about mumps but I have the measles, what do you get? I can talk to you about mumps but I got the measles. You catch who you are. Okay, that's a biggie, because we think that if we can just talk like today, you're going to get it. No, you're not going to get it, but this is going to help, okay? So I bring people into relationship. Now I'm going to give them ownership. I'm going to give them responsibility. And this is going to get messy. It's going to get messy. But the moment I step into the mess to take what? Control, I'm not empowering, okay? All right? And so that's why you need a theology of failure. Why? Because you're going to watch somebody fall over, okay? But listen, as you weigh up the risk of that, you're going to weigh up the risk that will this failure potentially kill the person? If it does, what are you going to do? You're going to step in and control. You're not going to let that happen, are you? Okay? But we as a movement tend to step in far too early. True? We're stepping in before people have actually, you know, learnt something from failure. We're always in the business of trying to protect. What is this? This is a controlling environment, not an empowering environment. So for me, that's what we've done. We've said to people, look, you're in charge of discipleship. I haven't got a clue what that means. Well, you know, I reckon I'm coming. I'm trying to form some things as a divisional commander. You know, I'd like to be able to say that. I'd like to be able to say, core officers in the room, why can't you say to some people, here, look, will you do this? You know, look, let's just pick on this. Health and safety audit, right? They say to you, we haven't got a clue what we're doing. You say, well, nor have I. Right? Most probably be true. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to let you take responsibility and ownership of it, and we'll journey together in relationship as we go through. So I'll use this moment as a discipleship moment to be able to do stuff. I've said to Glenda, I can't get it, because I look at officers in particular today, and I see how weighed down. And I say, I didn't think I ever was that weighed down. She says to me, no, you delegated it all. Yeah, what did I delegate it, or did I give ownership? Because, you see, for me, if it meant that you were going to come into my office once a week or twice a week, and the subject might be health and safety, there are people in this room that they know it will be 5 minutes right at the very end that we'll talk health and safety, because the first hour we'll be talking about where are we at, how are you going spiritually, because that's more important to me at this moment than health and safety. But we've got to get health and safety done, you know. Right? You say, well, I don't do that. Well, I'm saying to you, that's what I did. I think that's what I've done. That's through the years, and there are people in the room who'll know exactly what that means. And but to control, let's look at control, because I found this helpful. To control, to exercise authority and dominate influence over, to adjust to a requirement, this is to control, to regulate, to hold and restrain, to check, to reduce or prevent the spread of. We do this all the time. This is what we do. We're not going to develop leaders. We're not going to develop others. We're not going to develop your own kids if this is how you live. It's a really big one, I get people. I walk out of times like this, and they get me to do it this way, and they pat me on the back, and they say, "Oh, that was great, Ivan. Gee, that empowerment thing, man, that's a really good thing." And then they walk straight into life. And they control. And then we're wondering why we're not developing leaders. There are two extremes of control. One is called micromanagement. You heard that before? And the other one is called mushroom management. That mainly means you keep everybody in the dark and you just throw a lot of manure on it. And that's being polite. So, and they're the two extremes. I raised the two extremes, but just in case, because some of us pride ourselves on micromanagement. Now, you've heard me, eh? It's not demonic. You don't need to come and have prayer over it. It won't stop you from going to heaven, but it will definitely stop you from developing others. It'll definitely stop you from developing others. So let's get down to some nitty-gritty then as to how do I recruit people, in a sense. Well, one of the first things they'll do is they'll pray. Because I noticed that that's what Jesus did. The night before he goes selected some people, he prayed. Okay? Now, this might be a new step for some of us, but pray. All right? Pray that each day, that as you get into the day, you're going to have divine encounters. That's how I believe. I believe that all of us in this room, if you're possessed by the Holy Spirit, that your day has been set up for you by God. That everybody that you're going to meet today, God wanted you to meet. So I look for divine appointments. I look for divine appointments. I look for a moment, and it might mean, I've had several things happen to me of recent days. Like, for instance, the senior pastor of the largest congregation in Christchurch, gets up at his, he's just taking over. He was the youth pastor and now he's taking over. He gets up and during his testimony shares about the fact that he wouldn't even be a Christian today if there wasn't for a Salvation Army officer by the name of Ivan Bezzant. So there are people sitting in that congregation who know me, and they got hold of me and said, man, it's amazing. What did you, I don't even know this guy. What happens is I go to the church, I meet his wife, and his wife was just so excited because she basically says to me, if it wasn't for you, my husband wouldn't be who he is today. And I'm thinking, I've got to meet him because I can't even know, I don't even know what it was. And what it was that this young teenager was having such a bad time, they were trying to fit him into counselling when we were the core officers at Sydenham, that one of his caregivers, because he was such a ratbag, said to him, look, you're just burning everybody that you're touching. I'm taking you to our core officer, because he's a young guy, and I was in my late 20s. He says, he'll be able to talk to you. So he brings him in, and he reckons that, he tells me, this is his testimony, that within the hour that I spent with him, he had a divine encounter that led him to go chase God in such a way, I can't even remember it. But that's how significant it was. Divine appointment. You see, even Ivan on that day wasn't even aware of what was going on. You with me? But God was. And that's you. That's everybody in this room. This is what God is doing with you. So you're now praying. You're saying, God, please, I want to pour into people. I want to develop people. I want people develop into what? To the core? No. I want to develop people to become sons and daughters in your kingdom. That's the vision, isn't it? This is what I want. So now I'm going to live life and I'm not looking for divine appointments. I don't worry about the church thing. Why? Because Jesus said he'll build the church. Right? I'm just going to look at finding sons and daughters in the kingdom of God. I'm just going to look for those divine moments that I can bring people into, because everywhere I read about Jesus, it seemed to me he was worried more about the kingdom than the church. So even though I might find myself planted as a leader of the church, well, I'll leave God to worry about the church, and my divisional leaders will help me with that. Whatever. But, the thing is that all I'm trying to do is to get people to love God and to love people and to build into their lives such a hunger for the kingdom of God that it radically changes our world. That's what I'm after. So if I've got a school teacher in my midst, over the weekend I met two young ladies in Christchurch that are training to be school teachers. I found myself saying to both of them, you are the biggest missionary that we've got in this. And they were like, I thought we were just doing school teaching. I said to them, can I pray with you? Can I just, I just want you to know your names. I'm going to pray for you because you're in the Southern Division and you are going to be our greatest missionaries to young people. You might say, well, he's weird. No, I believe this stuff. I believe God wants to invade the impossible. I believe that God wants men and women to rise up every day and feel like a son and daughter of the King and to go out and fulfill vision. I look for it. You do. If you're saying, no, I don't, well, then you say, well, why does he develop leaders and I don't? Well, here's your beat. There it is. So just start changing your lifestyle. Try some of this, because there are people in this room who'll tell you that it seems to work for them as well. Okay, this last one. I didn't know. There are some of you who know where I'm going to go now. But you see, call people to be champions. And then I've got eagles or turkeys. Now, can I trust you guys? I'm getting it recorded. But listen, this is a secret to my life because I'm asked to share what I do. I see that Jesus touches everybody, but he doesn't allow everybody to get close to him and he pours into. True? In the Gospels? He will touch the multitudes, but at the end of the day, he'll only go back and spend time with a few. I'm of the belief that if God, this is the best way that I can do it by being nice, okay? Is that I believe that God calls me to love all people. But I want to actually be able to live and to really relate and, in a sense, to do life with everybody. True? So for me, I use this as an illustration. I want to be an eagle. I want to fly and be an eagle. So I'm best to spend time with eagles, not turkeys. Now, there's nothing wrong in being a turkey. Only if you were called to be an eagle. If you were called to be a turkey, you'll go live with the turkeys. But if you're called to be an eagle, you don't spend your best quality time pouring out your very best to turkeys. Do you understand this? Now people, I've got to be quite sensitive about this because, you know, I want everybody to have an encounter when they come near me that they might feel that I love all people. But the reality is that I have a strong calling in my life that I'm obeying the call of God upon my life, and that is that I would rise up as an eagle. And so I want to spend time with eagles in such a way that eagles would pour into me, that I would live with them, and whatever they carry, I would catch. Whatever I got, they would catch. That's where I want to live. I see it modeled in the life of Jesus. Okay? And so I just say to people, look, you know, I know some eagles, for instance, eagles today, who are just are burning out. You know why? Because they're spending too much time with turkeys. I don't know how else to put this, you know, but is it all right? Yeah, I could do it nicer, but it just helps me to understand this, okay? And so I'm just, I'm saying it's really important, I think, if you're going to develop people, because God will bring people into your life, and you will know that that is a divine appointment that I need to pour myself into. So where does the theology of don't get too close to people come in as officers? I'm sorry, I can't live it. I can't live it. It'll bring problems. It'll bring mess. But we'll find a way through the mess. But I can't stop. Why? Otherwise, what I'll do is I'll separate myself. How can I call people come close enough that they might catch what I'm carrying? All right? And some of you will say, well, look, I've got reasons why you can't do that. And I just want to say this. I've been a Salvation Army officer for 36 years now. And I reckon that there is nothing in this room that I haven't encountered. And I'm telling you, you're wrong. You need to get over your pain. Because at the end of the day, the way of the Lord is to call people into relationship. It's quite good. The business world are going to tell us it soon, so we'll hear it. You know, they're starting to say it now, so we'll be okay. Jesus has been saying it for a while now, but Now that the business world will start to say it, we might catch it. It's only relationship. Well, Jesus said that. Okay, anyway, move on. I can be a little controversial. Developing leaders. So when I've got a few minutes to finish on this. The difference that I notice with some people who are developing others better than others is this, that when I look at Jesus, I see that he has an agenda for their life when he meets with them. I too carry an agenda. The agenda that I would have is in this slide here. I would want to spend quality time with them. In other words, I want to do life. I do carry an agenda with people. This is just something that I got trained in, discipled in myself. I found it to be really helpful, that changed my life. So I want to share it with anybody else. So if you get near me, there'll be these areas that I would want to talk to you about. I'd want to talk to you about identity. I would want to talk to you about a sense of destiny, that you are of value to God and that God has a plan for your life. I'd want to talk to them about family, because I really believe family is really important. I would want to talk to them about servanthood, and that is this, that you won't really know who you are until you start to serve. All right? So if, you know, so it would be, you know, I would give somebody a task to do. Why? Because I'm going to see, they'll get to know who they really are as they begin to serve. I talk to them about militancy because I believe that that's the DNA of who we are, that God calls us to win a battle for him. And I would talk to them around accountability. Who is holding people accountable, holding you accountable? So that's the agenda that I would carry. And what I've done basically over the years, and I haven't got time to tell you all today, is I've developed my own thinking around each of those things so that now when I'm talking to somebody, I will talk to them around one of those areas, okay? And then I will always give the people, if I'm developing leaders, I give them an opportunity to serve. Not only do I give them responsibility, but I'll give them ownership. This is all going to rise and fall on how well you do now. And then we will evaluate, because I believe that's what, and then we'll have some courageous conversations. And that's where the whole ice cream thing comes in. People say to me, "You're the ice cream man." Yes, I am the ice cream man. How this came about, just so that you know, is that my dad used to have a strap on the wall, never used it, but Mum used to say, "Do you want your father to use the?" You know, that was always enough. You know what I mean? And I thought that's a really good method of telling people that you've just about crossed the line, right? So I started to say to people, "Why don't you and I go and have ice cream?" And ice cream represented in the teams that we were building. If I've ever said go and have an ice cream, you've just about crossed the line, right? Okay. So that's how it's happened. I remember one staff member one day he was out of control. As we walk out of the staff meeting, I said to him, "Hey, what about you and I going to have ice cream?" He said to me, "Am I that bad?" I said, "I think so." So that's how the it's a great, because you see, I don't know how to approach a really difficult thing, you know. So over the years, I've disguised it on, "Why don't we have ice cream?" Sometimes we don't even have to get to the issue, because my mum never had to. You with me? Because I realised, hey. Take stock here. What's going on here, you know? So that's how that came about. And always here, just to finish with, always to expose them to people who are making a difference. So anybody who's been around or who have been part of my life, they will get to know about guys like Dennis Peacock, Paul Jackson. There's a whole world of people that they will get exposed to. Why? Because that's who I was exposed to. And I will. The key here, last slide says, in developing people is that I build them into a team, a family who produces sons and daughters. All right. I filled up the hour for you. Honestly, I finish by saying I really do believe with all my heart that God is going to pour out His Spirit in a way that I agree with Gregory in the earlier session, that it's not just going to lead us to have more meetings, but it's actually going to lead us to raise up sons and daughters who will really make a difference. And if I can come out of Paul de Jong today with anything, I'm of the impression that at this moment we have an attitude problem within the movement. Our head space is telling us we can't do it. I just want to say to you today that it is possible for you to rise up, leaders. If you knew the insecurity that I feel in my life so often, you would question how could God use him. And I look around this room, and I'm of the belief that if God could radically get hold of your life today in such a way that you would love God passionately, and that you would love people, and that you would now just go and just do that. Just don't go looking, you know, I'm trying to say to people, I think the first step is don't go, you know, like this invading army. Actually, why don't we just go and live life? Because we're going to be connected with our world enough in a way that we will radically change our world. And so I'm of the belief that our best days are before us. I really do believe it. But I believe that the giant in the room is a controlling environment, not an empowering environment. And I, with you, would love to journey with a few of you to see how we can change that world, because I believe it's possible. God bless you. Thank you.